Blessed be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbors as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us. Join with me in the Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Stir up, O Lord, the wills of your faithful people, that bringing forth in abundance the fruit of good works, they may be abundantly rewarded when our Savior Jesus Christ comes to restore all things. Who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
And you may be seated and attentive to the reading of God's word.
The men who are complacent, those who say in their hearts, "The Lord will not do good, nor will he do ill." Their goods shall be plundered, and their houses laid waste. Though they build houses, they shall not inhabit them. Though they plant vineyards, they shall not drink wine from them. The great day of the Lord is near, near and hastening fast. The sound of the day of the Lord is bitter. The mighty man cries aloud there. A day of wrath is that day, a day of distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness, a day of trumpet blast and battle cry against the fortified cities and against the lofty battlements. I will bring distress on mankind so that they shall walk like the blind, because they have sinned against the Lord. Their blood shall be poured out like dust, and their flesh like dung. Neither their silver nor their gold shall be able to deliver them on the day of the wrath of the Lord. In the fire of his jealousy, all the earth shall be consumed. For a full and sudden end he will make all the inhabitants of the earth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm this morning is Psalm 90. We'll read it responding at the asterisk. Lord, you have been our refuge
from one generation to another.
Before the mountains were brought forth, or the earth and the world were made,
you were our God for everlasting, and the world without end.
You turned man back to the dust.
You say, return, O children of men.
For a thousand years in your sight are as yesterday,
even as the day that is past.
You scatter them as night watch that comes quickly to an end.
They are even as a dream that fade away.
They are like the grass, which in the morning is green,
but in the evening is dry.
so strong that they come to 80 years.
Yet it is the same that labors in sorrow, so soon it passes away, and we are gone.
But who regards the power of your wrath?
And who considers the fierceness of your anger?
So teach us to number our days,
that we may apply our hearts to wisdom.
Our second reading is from 1 Thessalonians. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers, you have no need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves are fully aware the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying, there is peace and security, the sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you are not in darkness, brothers, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light, children of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. So then, let us not sleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, the kingdom of heaven will be as when a man going on a journey called his servants and entrusted to them his property. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. Now, after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. And he who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 talents more, saying, Master, you delivered to me 5 talents. Here I have made 5 talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. And he also who had the 2 talents came forward, saying, Master, you delivered to me 2 talents. Here I have made 2 talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. He also who had received 1 talent came forward, saying, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you do not sow, and gathering where you do not winnow. So as I was afraid, I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours. But his master answered him, You wicked and slothful servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sowed, and gather where I have not winnowed. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and at my coming I should have received what is my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has 10 talents. For to everyone who has will more be given, and he will have abundance. But from him who has not, even what he has will be taken away. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise you, Lord Christ.
Words my mouth, meditation my heart, always be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. You may be seated. Get comfortable. Gracious. Glad you're here today. If you are one of those who use the little devotional, the daily bread, the new batch came in, and they're out there on there where you sign in and Yeah, so they're on top of there. Also there are some copies of the book, When the Lord is My Shepherd. I know some of you like the book, and some of you maybe know someone who may enjoy reading it this holiday, and or may need to read some of the things that are there. If you can use one of those books and give one away to someone, whether it's a Christmas present or whatever, they're free. Just pick them up and take them. If you don't take them and you don't use them, they'll just sit around here at the church for ages until they'll get moved from one room to the next room to the next room, and eventually they'll find themselves in a box out by the curb. So I encourage you to put them to good use. If you found it a blessing, bless somebody else. Pick up one, pick up two, however many you use. Or if you just want to read it again, you know, pick up another copy, you know, so if you wore your last one out. So anyway, but those are free. Those are there. I don't know if you've paid attention to the readings, or if you get this sense from the readings here of late. Next Sunday is Christ the King Sunday. It's the last Sunday of the church year. And the readings this week, or the last couple weeks, and then in through Advent, where they're preparing us for Christmas. They're preparing us for the great day of the Lord, when the Lord finally steps down into this realm, and we confront him, and we get to see him. And so the readings tend to, it's hard to tell whether you're reading scripture that's 1,000 years old or the daily newspaper. They sound grim. You know, I'm listening to that one from Zephaniah, and I'm going, oh my gosh, that sounds, whoa, you know. But that's kind of the theme for right here. There is this woven within all the readings that with the coming day of the Lord, while we might think it's going to be really nice, it always contains an element of judgment. And most of us, that makes squirm. None of us. It's kind of like the big test that we're pretty sure we didn't study for. You know, we've been given a lifetime. You know, we've been given this, and someday there's going to be a pop quiz. So really, not only are they difficult to read and meditate and sit with, but they're very difficult to preach. And so I was having some trouble this week looking at this, and part of the problem is, I learned this parable as a child. This was one of my first epiphanies this week. I learned this as a child. You know, a lot of us learn things as children that hold true the rest of our lives. You know, to look both ways before you cross the street. The stove in use is generally hot, and it's a good idea not to touch it. There are some things that we learn that need to adapt, morph, and change, and grow in depth to have any real meaning or to keep us relevant in the world around us. If I told you I believed in Santa Claus and didn't provide you the context of why I believe, you might think that I'm a child who has never grown up, which has often been said about me. But you would think that, or you would think that I was delusional, or that I really hadn't matured, or there was something wrong with me, because it's something as a truth I learned as a child, and yeah, there is something about Christmas that needs that figure, but I need to define that for this moment. I need to define it as an adult. The problem was, when I was a child and I learned this parable, I was probably sitting in Sunday school. And my allowance at that time was probably like 50 cents. At the time, I had two other brothers. So it just made sense in this parable, when I'm hearing it, that it's my dad, my boss, my whatever, giving me my weekly allowance, 50 cents, and giving my brother a quarter, because, you know, he's just my brother, he's littler. And giving the younger brother, Matt, Mike, just giving him a dime. Gave us something that was fit for our age, something that if I wasted it all on candy, it wasn't going to throw me into a coma fit, or wouldn't throw my brother Mike into a coma fit, because you can only buy so much for 10 cents. But that's the way I heard the parable. And in that, and that coupled with the verse there that he comes in, where the steward, or the man with the slave with only one talent, he goes, "Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not scatter. So I was afraid. I went and hid the talent in the ground." Gosh, if I look at this as something little, if I look at this in the framework I had there when I was a child, it's no wonder that I look up at God, who's going to require something out of me at the day of judgment, as a harsh man and a scary event. It doesn't have to be that way. I was learning something, and I can't, when I tell you I was studying this week, it's not like I learned something new. I have sat in Sunday school classes since the day of age 5. I have been to churches. I have heard sermons. I have heard teachings. I have taught classes. I have written classes. I have had, you know, I've studied both in and out of college. I was a religion major. I went to seminary. It's not like I learned anything new this week. I am sure this fact was there. But when I talk to you about the Word of God being living, this is what I'm talking about. Suddenly running across something in scriptures, and God goes, "Whoa, whoa, this right here, pay attention here." And when you look at it, and when you examine it, you see it in a new light, and it's applied differently, and it fits for this moment. The problem with this parable for me when I was growing up is I was always looking at it through the eyes of when I first learned it. Learning it as a talent. And then as I got a little older, some Sunday school teacher told me that I should take my talents and serve the Lord. But I'm not that talent. So I always saw myself as a servant with one talent. A matter of fact, when I was wrestling about what to do with my vocation, where I was going to be, and what God was calling me to be, and I'm wrestling through all these things that I cannot do, that I can't do. I'm not going to go be a missionary. I'm not going to do this. I can't sing, Lord. I can't be, you know, I come down with, and this is literally true, I said, "God, I can talk." You see, nobody even argued with that. You know? Nobody even, I said, but that was it. That moment with God, I said, "Look, I can talk. If you can use my talking, then you can have it." And he has. And I've been able to talk myself into trouble, and once or twice been able to talk myself out of trouble. And somewhere in there, I hope that I've taught something that he's wanted me to teach. So I only have, and I've always seen myself as this guy with one little talent. I can talk about it. So this week, when I either rediscovered something that I should have already known, but this little fact come up and quickened, and I went, "Oh, this changes the whole story." A talent is not a gift or a skill that God gives you. A talent is actually a measure of weight. One talent equals 6,000 denarii. A denarii equals a day's wage. When the good master, when the master come over and he gave his one, then we'll talk about this little guy that only had one, because the numbers are small and I can do that math. He was given him 16 years of salary. 16 years. He was basically handing him a retirement fund. I said, "Look, it's a unit of weight. It's not really a coin, or it's not like a $100 bill or something like that that's got some sort of worth. A talent was 75 pounds. So what he actually gave this servant was 75 pounds of either silver or gold. And yet he ends up being called a lazy servant, and he actually drug it somewhere where nobody would find it, dug a deep hole for a 75-pound hunk of silver, you know, and then went and re-dug it back up when the master came home. I think a lot of times we learn something new, or we see it in a certain light, and we totally forget the depth of this. This guy could have taken this silver, I'm going to say it was silver, okay, he could have taken this 75 pounds of silver, this 16-year wages, and when his master went to the east, he could have gone to the west and lived happily ever after for the next 16 years. stopped it all, stuck it, gave it to his financial planner, and had a retirement fund, and lived pretty comfortably for the rest of his life. He didn't just give him one. He gave him something huge. And when it shifts to why you give someone like that, or why you are doing that or learning that, it really moves the focus over to the giver. And it shifts the story around just a little bit. God has given you gifts and talents generously. In fact, let me retell the story. It's something that may just kind of make it make sense to some of us, or at least for my simple mind. The owner of a business was getting ready to leave. His business was the property, or the reason he has this business was all for the sake of his son. His business would one day belong to his son. But he had to leave. He had to go. So he went to his first employee, who was doing all the office and administrative work, and he gave him 5 talents, or 30,000 shares in the company. And he came to the next guy, the skilled labor guy that was also doing some of the supervising work, and he gave him 12,000 shares in the company. And then he bumped over to the guy that was a janitor and said, here's 6,000 shares of the company. How clean do you think the floors would be if the janitor knew that he owned the company? You are the brothers and sisters of Christ, who owns the world, who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, who owns this world. The giver, God, the boss, God, the supreme authority, God has looked at us and said, not that he's given us something to do, some sort of responsibility, something that he's going to be a taskmaster for at the end of the day, but he has generously given us this. Not just one talent, but he's given us a share in this, his son's business, job, opportunity, world. We are heirs with him in God of everything that Christ gives. Shifts the story some, because now you're looking at the little guy and go, well, whoa, you've got a responsibility. He hasn't just given you, like in the way I learned the story, burying 10 cents didn't make any difference at all. You give me 10 cents or just one penny as I leave the door, I'm just going to toss it my little change thing in the car. I'm never going to think about it again. You give me part of the business you own, better believe I'm going to think about it. I'm going to act differently. I'm going to live differently. I'm going to react differently. I'm going to tell the story differently. In the very beginning, when he gave them money to leave, this owner, this master of the story, was actually giving him his family. They were giving him part of his wealth. They were participating in everything that he was and does. It's not that he's harsh, he's generous. And he's given us more than we could ever ask or imagine. So when we start wrapping our head around that, and so when we start shifting that thing, that God is not this heavy taskmaster that's coming at the end of the age or at the day of accounting, and I'm suddenly going to fall short on like every other test I've ever done, or I'm going to be held accountable for something that I don't even know how to do, or maybe I didn't even discover that I had talents until I was late in life. Here's what shifting it does for us. Keeps us from thinking of ourselves too lightly. That what we do and what we choose to do and what we think and how we give and how we live doesn't really does impact those in and around us. We are, if we are co-heirs with Christ, if we are part of us is actually sitting with God at his right hand in glory, do you think it matters how we live? How we interact with one another? Whether we forgive or don't forgive? How generous we are? Who we include in our family with us? Who we exclude? Do you think what we say and how we say it matters? Suddenly, we become something different. We become more ambassadors. We become more sharers, and we own a part of all of this that is. We don't just have a dime running around. We understand that he's the giver of all good things, and if we kind of shift that perspective around that we have been given a lot and start looking at how much it's actually worth, should impact how we live, how we treat one another. And that's the other thing it does as well. Because if you are also co-heir with Christ, how dare I speak evil of you? How dare I try to exploit you? How dare I try to abuse you, lie to you, cheat you? You have never looked into the eyes of someone that God does not love. You have never encountered or engaged somebody that God does not love. I don't care how bitter that person was. I don't care how angry that person was. I don't care what that person said to you or did to you in that moment. You have to know that God loves them as well. We get a picture of who this does. It kind of puts in perspective the way we treat one another and how we compare ourselves to one another. I don't look at that anymore like, oh, I've only got one little talent. This is all I can do. And then I'm jealous of this guy that seems to have everything. And he's got all these talents, and he's been able to use them, and the world loves him, and this, that, and the other, and it's kind of like, oh, and everything he does, nothing goes wrong. You ever meet those kind of people? Oh, I just want to throw rocks. No, they're perfect. You know, come on, do something. Spill a drink, you know. Scuff the shoe, do something. You know, but there's these people, so we start looking at these people, well, look, they got all the gifts, no wonder. God must really love them. And then we turn around and we look at the other people and they go, well, at least maybe I got two talents, you know? Because there's always somebody greater and always somebody less than you, right? There's always somebody greater and somebody less. And if you don't know really how to approach them, there is that temptation to lift some people on a pedestal and they're perfect and can do no wrong. And put other people and treat them outcast or less than, totally forget it. Even if it's the fact that that comparison, well, I didn't kill anybody and I'm not Hitler, so I know I'm going to heaven. There's never been a person on this earth that God has not loved. There's never been a person on this earth that does not have that potential to be co-heirs with you. Why would you want to treat your brothers and sisters that way? Why would you want to diminish them? Be jealous of them? Why not rejoice with them? So, not only is it like how I fit in and where I am and how I fit in with others, but if we look at this properly, if we look at this big at what we've been given, and God is a good giver, we begin to see exactly what God has called us to do with our little talent, our retirement fund, our 6,000 days of labor. We begin to see what we and how important it is for us as co-heirs to take care of this world to take care of the things of God. And a lot of the things of God are people. To make sure that the hungry are fed, the homeless are sheltered, that violence ends and justice reigns. We're responsible for that. And you start seeing how you have this obligation to put back in, much like the janitor who now owns a part of the company. Everything that he does now affects the company. So keep it clean. Polish things that are supposed to be polished. Disinfect. I mean, we'll bring it right to 2020. We'll context this sermon. I'll never be able to listen to it again. Disinfect everything, you know? You take your role differently when you know that you're a part owner. And when you see what God was wanting to do or how you fit into God's big plan, yes, you may not be a priest. Yes, you may not be a teacher. But there is plenty in God's kingdom for you to do. Matter of fact, there's more for you to do. Your responsibilities are even greater than mine. I know. I can't get away from the fact that someday we will head out to be judged. Someday we will be held in account with all the blessings that God has given us. And in this country, and in this time, and in this place, in this community, we've been given a lot. And in the faith is co-heirs. If we come back and squander the company, if we come back and ruin it for the Son, yeah, we'll probably find a harsh taskmaster who will call us exactly what we were, evil and lazy. Why? Because if we squander it, that's what we are. In the beginning, when he gave me the talent, I'm co-heir. If I don't act like it, it's exactly what he's going to call me. I'm looking forward to Christ the King. I'm looking forward to Advent. And maybe rethinking some of this, preparing the way of the Lord, and making straight his path. And getting ready to again at Christmas, at the Nativity, to encounter him again and anew in his word, in one another, and in this season. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may stand. Join me as we confess our faith. Words found in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit in the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead, and the life of the world to come. Amen. Amen. Let us do it for prayer.
us pray for the church and for the world. Almighty and ever-living God, we are taught by your holy word to offer prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all people. We humbly ask you to mercifully receive our prayers. Inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all who confess your holy name may agree in the truth of your holy word and live in unity and godly love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray that you will lead the nations of the world in the way of righteousness, and so guide and direct their leaders that your people may enjoy the blessings of freedom and peace. Grant that our leaders may impartially administer justice, uphold integrity and truth, restrain wickedness and vice, and protect true religion and virtue. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Give grace, Heavenly Father, to all bishops, priests, and deacons, and especially to your servants Foley, our Archbishop, and William and Richard, our own bishops, that by their life and teaching they may proclaim your true and life-giving word and rightly and duly administer your holy sacraments. And to all your people, give your heavenly grace, especially to this congregation, that with reverent and obedient hearts we may hear and receive your holy word and serve you in holiness and righteousness all the days of our lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Prosper, we pray, all those who proclaim the gospel of your kingdom throughout the world, and strengthen us to fulfill your great commission, making disciples of all nations, baptizing them, and teaching them to obey all that you have commanded. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We ask you in your goodness, O Lord, to comfort and sustain all who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We remember before you all your servants who have departed this life in your faith and fear, especially Sharon Tadra, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we ask you to give us grace to follow the good example of the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. John the Apostle, and all your saints, that we may share with them in your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for the sake of Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Maker and Judge of us all, we acknowledge and lament our many sins and offenses, which we have committed by thought, word, or deed, against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your righteous anger against us. We are deeply sorry for these our transgressions. The burden of them is more than we can bear. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may evermore serve and please you with the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And with your spirit.
Share a sign of Christ's peace with those who love.
Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might,
heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
All praise and glory is yours, O God, our heavenly Father. For in your tender mercy, you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption. He made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. And he instituted, and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue, a perpetual memory of his precious death and sacrifice until his coming again. So now, O merciful Father, in your great goodness, we ask you to bless and to sanctify with your word and Holy Spirit these gifts of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. For in the night in which he is betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, according to the institution of your dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we, your humble servants, celebrate and make here before your divine majesty with these holy gifts the memorial your Son has commanded us to make. Remembering his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and his promise to come again. And here we offer and present unto you, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice. We humbly pray that all who partake of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with your grace and heavenly benediction, and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him, by him and with him and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen."
Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs on your table, but you are the same Lord whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our
our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Grant us your peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. almighty and ever-living God. We thank you for feeding us in these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us of your favor and goodness towards us, that we are true members of the mystical body of your Son, the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs to the hope of your everlasting kingdom. And we humbly ask you, Heavenly Father, to assist us with your grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all of the works that you have prepared for us to walk in through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Grant, Almighty God, that the words we have heard this day with our ears may be by your grace be grafted into our hearts, that they may bring forth in us the fruit of a righteous life, to the honor and praise of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Are there any announcements that we need to be aware of, either with the crest or with the angel tree or anything? Nothing. Okay, angel tree's working both online and the tree's up, but there's nothing on it yet.
Right,
yeah.
The angel tree were kept online and everyone received a link.
Okay.
And that's a very good way to do angel tree. And then we also, our tree is going up hopefully today. We just had to verify our families. Mm-hmm. And so we'll be putting the little angels on the tree today.
Good, good. The crest, is there anything you need to know?
Everything's good.
Everything's running good.
We'll start next Sunday. Well, actually, start next Saturday. We'll start.
Yeah, so next Saturday we're starting to prepare for Sunday. The crest is looking really different this year. We don't have to move anything today. We're not moving furniture or rearranging the church, so that's kind of different, but there's a whole nother hunk of work that's going on, and we're glad you're a part of it. And for those who have set out, supported, and volunteer, thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm also aware of the irony of telling you the only gift I have is to be able to talk, and then not be able to talk.
Yeah.
Every once in a while, God goes, see, it's not your talent to begin with. So anyway, I apologize for that. But yes,
the greening on the tree.
Greening on the tree.
That's going to be December 6th.
Second Sunday of Advent, we will green the tree. Okay, and finally, also, it's no mystery if you've been following the news or listening to our governor or stuff like that. Things look scary in and around here. Keep an eye on your email, on Facebook, on every other way we can try to get the word to you. If anything changes from our normal routine, we will let you know, okay? As soon and as best as we can, okay? One way or the other. But it helps if you're paying attention to those forms of communication. Or if you have any questions or something, call and ask, okay? All right, thank you.
Go in peace, the love, and serve the Lord.